Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Hall Center for the Humanities for this discussion with our wonderful guest, Kate Boo. I hope you had the opportunity to come to her talk last night, in which she gave a very moving and quite intimate account of her investigation into the lives of the slums of Mumbai. I'm Shaida Jahanbani. I'm a professor in the Department of History, and I study the history of poverty reform efforts, especially in the developing world. So I have all sorts of questions, but I'm hoping that you also have brought lots of questions to ask in this discussion, which will be very freewheeling. Just feel free to raise your hand. We have some microphones in the back that will come to you, and hopefully we can have a really nice exchange. Kate is a very warm participant. I just want to briefly introduce her. As I say, you've probably already heard lots of introductions because you were at the lecture last night, but Kate Boo has spent years reporting about the lives of people on the margins of modern capitalist society, both in the United States and abroad. She has been recognized by the MacArthur Genius Program as a genius, so we're sitting next to an official genius here. Do you have any theorems you'd like to discuss?
All I know is it causes a lot of amusement in my household when I drop the phone in the toilet and things like that.
My graduate advisor was a MacArthur Grant winner, and her husband just called himself Mr. Genius. Kate has also received a Pulitzer Prize, and her book, this wonderful, wonderful book, Behind the Beautiful Forevers, has received the National Book Award. So I'd just like to welcome her here. She's going to speak for just a few minutes, and then we'll launch right into some questions. So thank you for coming, Kate.
Thank everybody for coming. So were many of you at this talk last night? Okay, some of you. So my work is a combination of immersion journalism and investigative journalism. Really going after documents in addition to spending long periods of time collecting the stories of people in low-income communities. And my interest is not in sort of hand-wringing depictions of what poverty looks like. I'm really interested in how people think and choose and negotiate their way out of poverty. I'm interested in the social mechanisms by which people born here can get here. And the way that I started this approach to my work, it came out of a series of weaknesses. And I think I felt there was a tremendous need for nuanced, non-ideological reporting on how government and philanthropic efforts were changing the lives of the poor. Were they working? Were they not? I felt that there just wasn't any substantive hard reporting on that subject. A lot of it was sentimental. But I was also really, really shy. And so I was the last person in the world who was going to go into a government office and say, hey, tell me everything. I remember early on in my career meeting a prominent official for an interview, and I was so nervous, I sat down and I missed the chair. And the next thing I remember is the guy I hit the table, I blacked out, and he's picking me up. I thought, okay, this is not going to be, this access sort of journalism is not going to be my jam. So I ended up, that's how I ended up becoming, using the Freedom of Information Act. It's an amazing law. So my life depended on it because I found you could get the true story of what was actually happening to money allocated in Washington, for instance, when what was happening to it, and compare it to what was actually going on the side of the, in the neighborhoods where low-income people were living. You could investigate, and I'm investigating land records, business records. You could see how the government official gave the contract to his friend who, bought the $4 million house instead of spending it on the poor. You could really trace the money in a way, and at the same time understanding how anti-poverty policy looks from the point of view of the people who were making their own choices to improve their lives. Another weakness that I had to address early on in my reporting was that when I was in a room with, whether it was whether a slum hut or a public housing project, and I was watching people and listening to people, I had just a terrible visual memory. So I'd be listening with all my heart, and then afterward, I'd go to write, I think, were the walls green? Were they blue? Was that a bird in the corner or was it a goat? I had no, it was just, I had, it was some flaw in my, the way that I process information. So I just, every time I would try to, I just wasn't confident. And so that, so then I started bringing a camera and then ultimately a video camera so that I could document the things that were maybe not important to me at the time, as important as the conversation that was happening in front of me. But afterward, I could watch it, you know, and have utter confidence when I wrote that what I was describing, you know, at least visually was documented, that I was correct about it. And so using those documentary tools, the tape recorder, the tape recorder to make sure what's said, the camera to make sure what was seen, and then ultimately video camera, it's allowed me to have much more conviction than I otherwise would have had in my writing. And it's allowed me to write more, people sometimes say cinematically, and that's not a reflection of my gifts as much as it is a reflection, I think, of my recognition that I had certain weaknesses and that I had to address them if I wanted to pursue my passion. So that's just a general, you know... Right. Yeah, I mean, I'm a big believer in facing up to what you suck at.
I wish more students could hear that. So what I'd like to do is actually ask sort of the first question. I'll take the prerogative of being the moderator. As I mentioned to Kate a few minutes ago, most of the people who I study are liberal activists who are interested in the lives of the poor and are trying to very much influence public policy, both at home and abroad. But most of the people I study are no longer alive, so I don't get to ask them questions. I have to make my own sort of deductions based on what they've left behind. And so I'd like to take this opportunity to ask about the process. You spoke last night a lot about sort of your project and what you want to do with your work and what you have done. But I really want to know about the sort of nitty-gritty of, you know, your first day in Anawadi, or, you know, even how you sort of picked that site and how you approach these people who you introduce us to and sort of built these relationships with them.
Right. So when I choose a narrative project, whether it's a story for The New Yorker or this book, I'm looking to live in the question. So what was interesting to me? And one of the things that was very interesting to me broadly was that I talked about this last night a little bit, how I felt that these issues of globalization and inequality were over-theorized and under-reported. There were a great number of people talking about what was really going on in poor communities, but when you're a poverty reporter, you also can tell by reading who's done that actual work of being in those communities and who's had a guided tour of a slum by the head of a software company. So you really, not to mention any names, I thought that whatever I ended up doing, I could at least do some solid documentary work that hadn't otherwise been done. And that's always in the back of my mind when I'm choosing a project. If someone else is doing it well, I'm rooting for them. There's not enough of us doing it. So whatever, you know, if I feel like somebody else has got it, then I'm going to do something else. But it was something that I felt wasn't being done well. I settled on Mumbai because it was the financial capital, and as well as the film capital. And also, as it happened, it was the city that I knew best, because when I married my husband, who's Indian, he's an Indian historian and public intellectual and a fantastic person. When I got to know him in 2001, the city that he spent most of his time was Mumbai. So I'd had, before I started the project, I'd had 7 years of getting to know the city. And because I work on poverty, I couldn't just turn off the part of my brain that wanted to know what was happening in poor communities, even though I didn't feel for a long time that I had the right to tell those stories. So eventually I did, after tripping over an unabridged dictionary and realizing that, you know, it was one of those situations where I hurt myself, I couldn't get to the phone, and I had these hours where I was thinking, what if I'm paralyzed? What would I regret that I didn't do? And that was the project that I thought I would regret not doing. So then I gathered my strength and I went to Mumbai and just started out, and the first days were god-awful. They were just awful. I didn't know what I was doing. I could barely, you know, what I feel strongly about is that when I start a project like this, that I don't go to an NGO or an organization that many people and say, here, mediate for me, find your people, tell me the success stories. I just walk in, you know, and go around and walk into as many different places as I can bear and try to find somebody to talk to me. And in the case of this book, I started working in 6 different slums. And I would find people who had a little English because my Hindi was terrible, and start to get to know the community that way. And so for the first 6 months of this project, I was working on, in places that I cared about the people. I still care about the people as much as I care about the people of Annawadi. But one of the things that became clear in those early days is that in Annawadi, there was more hope for advancement than there was in the other slums. Mm. And that was because of the airport. That was because it was surrounded by luxury hotels. That was because kids sometimes got day work or night work at the hotel. So there was this sense of, there was a real sense that in this community, it was possible to break the barrier between the poor world and the rich world. So I felt it there from early on, but it took me months of being there day and night to really feel that I was able to practice the watching and listening type of journalism that I typically do, because obviously I was a freak in the slum. And, in the beginning, people would, like, there would be 200 people outside the door of a hut when I was talking to somebody. That's not the way that you begin to understand what people think. And I do remember a very, very happy day in the course of the reporting in which I was sitting in this garbage, this shed of garbage that Abdul Hussein had built to keep his recyclables. And I was sitting there on on the trash with my laptop, doing what I always do, and I was just watching him categorize. And some kids from another slum came by, and they were just like, what? Who's this woman in this place? What? And they were, and the Annawadi kids were like, that's just Kate. She's just here. You know, what's the big deal? You guys are so uncool, thinking it's not normal. Here she is. And I knew that then that was, the kids really had absorbed this as a part of the, what they had, and that they thought other kids were ridiculous for not getting it. So.
And during those first 6 months, how did you introduce yourself and sort of what did you say you were there to do? I'm assuming you told them you were there to write a story.
Right, right. I mean, there's people have different approaches for things, but I think that going back to what I was saying about being a shy person trying to do this work is I'm no good at the smiling, charming, hi, I want to be your friend, tell me your story thing. I just don't have, that's not in my toolkit. So I go into a story wherever I'm working and I say, this is what I do. This is the work that I, have done in the past. This is work that I feel has meaning, because I think that if people who have a little more wealth and power have a more sophisticated and granular understanding of what's actually happening in poor communities, that maybe they would think differently. Maybe the stereotypes would be a little less. And that's what I say that I'm doing. And I say, what I'm asking you for is something really strange, and it's an intrusion, and I say something that is absolutely true. I don't think I would allow somebody to do it to me. But I say that, and I say, what I want to do is to follow you in your day and, come to know you not just from what you say about your life, but from what you do and how you choose, in hopes that, that if we work together and do this, that it might make some difference. I also tell people that maybe it will make no difference, because I've seen it happen both ways. I've seen real change happen from the work, and I've seen nothing happen. Mm-hmm. So there's no guarantee. I've felt that way particularly in India. I had no idea what had happened. And there were people in the slum who didn't want to do that. They were like, no. And that's fine. Yeah. You don't try to press them. And then there are people who are so enthusiastic about doing it that they're not exactly, that, you know, they're not necessarily the best people to do it. The people who and this is true of most of the people who you've met in the book, if you've read it, are people who thought about it long and hard and decided to participate. And the key thing is that midway through the project, they can also decide not to participate. So for me, the risk is, and it's happened before, that you can be writing about somebody and documenting their lives for years, and then at the end they say, I've changed my mind. And you have to let that happen. I mean, ultimately, when you write a book with real names, you have to make sure that those people are active and willing participants in that project, because otherwise you're just, you know, you're selling them out for your own interests. And I've had it happen. I did an intense project in South Boston in a Haitian community, following kids in a school, and I followed an amazing family for 9 months, and then they had a voodoo priest, the mother did, and she had mental health issues, and the priest decided it was a bad idea for her to participate, so they pulled out of the story, and at the last minute it was the New Yorker, and they were saying, where's the story? Oh, wow. And I had to take somebody I'd been following, who wasn't the center of my reporting, and move him forward. But I think that's the only ethical way to do it. I absolutely don't want to publish a story or a book where anybody corrupt public officials, I don't ask their permission to be named. If you have a public responsibility and you're misusing it, I'm going to use your name and documents. But if you're an ordinary citizen, they have to be participants.
So, and I'll turn it over in just one second, but I just want to ask one follow-up on that. A character like Asha.
Mm-hmm.
So she is, in a way, a sort of emerging public official, or she wants to be.
Right.
And she is engaged in corruption.
Right.
But you obviously developed a relationship with her and also sort of were able to access her humanity. And so was that, was she sort of a borderline case for you, where you were kind of keen on exploring the way in which she was part of the system, so
right.
to speak, but also you wanted to kind of, reveal the motivations she had for that.
Right. I mean, so if you haven't read the book, Asha is her husband is an alcoholic. When I have my videotapes and I look at films from the house, you often see just 2 feet sticking up, and that's the husband. They're just stepping over him. You know, he's on the floor. She's trying to raise 3 kids. Her daughter has a chance to be the first female graduate in the slum, and so she embraces corruption in anti-poverty programs as a way to get her daughter a better education. And so I watch, this incredibly elaborate effort, ultimately successful, to basically steal from the poor to make her own family secure. And I name her name. I name the corrupt official she worked with. In fact-checking and talking about what was in the book, there was a higher standard for going over it and over it and over it with her before it was published. But what she says something in the last chapter, which is what she firmly believes. She says, why is it my corruption when the big people say that it's right? And that is an essential question about that society, is whose corruption is it if the officials are using her to divert money to their friends in the elite? Why is her action, essentially immoral? It's, in that society.
Right.
She's behaving, according to the example set at the top. And I think, and she really believed that. And she said, and why should I lie? This is my life and this is what I've had to do. Why should I lie?
Mm-hmm. All right, fascinating. So let's open it up and we'd love to hear from you. Excuse me.
Hi.
There's a microphone coming your way.
Do you still go to Anwadi, or are you through with that slum, and what are you doing now?
I still go to Anwadi. I'm not through with the slum. When I come places like Lawrence, they pay me some money, and I take the money and I put it back in the community or in other communities like it. And so that sounds like nice and toasty and good, but it's in a, it's work. Things you do, things they go wrong. It's a constant recalibration of, you know, of what can be done, what, you know, what's not working. Sometimes I'll give you an example. Is one thing I did early on was I put a lot of kids into school in the surrounding area, as many as we could in the best schools, and then the best schools didn't stop wanting to take our kids and then put them in second and third, you know, but certainly better than what they had. But what I realized after a while is that was exacerbating inequality in the slum, because it was mostly the boys who were allowed to go to these schools, who were allowed to travel a little further, and the girls in the slum weren't, you know. So I had to start something in the slum, but the airport authority wouldn't let me build a proper space, so we have to do, so now we have a tailoring and English school in a bunch of slum huts. And, next month I'll see something is wrong with that. We'll have created too many tailors in a small community that there's not enough money for all of them to make a living. We'll have to adjust in that. So I'm there all the time, and it's a constant struggle. And one of the funny things is that, you know, that in the beginning, I mean, it's still to this day, I've had to pay nonprofit organizations to supervise some of these things. I've had to pay them so much because they take one look at the place and they're like, well, we don't want to work there. So it's like you could, you know, essentially bribe people into the environment. But when you get them in there, then the people in that environment keep them there.
Have you ever engaged in this kind of work in other communities you've reported on? Or is this the first?
I've always been involved in my own, you know, private life. I've never had money like this before, you know. I've always been engaged in educational efforts, or whatever, on my own. But what often happened is sometimes I would be writing for the Washington Post or the New Yorker, and I would put the article out, and then people would come together over the issue, and sometimes laws were changed, and sometimes families' lives were transformed. And you know, that was interesting in a, you know, and really has, I mean, crazy stories like of kids who were, you know, kids who were considered autistic and bound for group homes who are now college graduates. I mean, the stories just of those interventions, the difference they make, that, you know, they're extraordinary stories. And someday, you know, maybe, so I idly think about telling them all that, I'm not sure. But in this case, the book had come out. And while the Indian government was interested and more supportive and receptive to the criticism than I dreamed, it wasn't that readers, like even in Mumbai, it was read by many people in the elite, but nobody was saying, I want to do something. Mm-hmm. And then I had a gig at Michigan State University, and they were paying me to do this, you know, they were paying me $10,000 to do some convocation. And I thought, this is immoral. How can I take $10,000 to talk about them when, you know, so that from that point, I talked to my publishers at Random House. I talked to lawyers, made sure that, you know, that everybody agreed that was an ethical choice. And so started putting proceeds into the community then. And they're like the people that I write about, there are so many other people in that slum, in the villages with much, much greater need. So it's a, you know, it's an effort to try to reach many people, not just the people who are featured in the slum. And also people in Vidarbha, the rural part of the state where Asha's family is from, we're also working there.
Wow. This book is, you're never going to be finished with this book.
No, I have a problem with closure. Like everybody I've ever written about at the New Yorker or whatever, I still am in touch and friends and, you know, so yeah. But when you get that, you know, when you spend that much time with people, and they risk so much to be, when you read a story like this from, I mean, whether it's George Packer's The Unwinding or David Finkel's book on soldiers, Thank You for Your Service, you look and there's the real name of somebody and the intimate details of their life. They participated with the reporter in the project. They risk more than we do. And, you know, that's courage that you don't forget when the book is done. You can't just say later. See ya.
All right. Other questions? Yes.
I remember you.
Yeah. Yes. You spoke last night about the health issues. How did you maintain your own health when you were doing this extended reporting while in the slum? And talking about that further, you know, because we have the issues on water and so forth, but just for your own self, protecting yourself and making sure you didn't get any more illnesses. Mm.
Well, I mean, I'm definitely the worst for the wear. There's no question. You know, you see before and after pictures and it's frightening, but that's because of the environmental situation there. And it's, you know, there was this moment where before I left to start this project, my husband, he was in Washington. You know, he said to me, I said that my overmastering concern is when you make your choices, you protect yourself first. And I cried like a baby because I knew that I wasn't going to do that. Because the thing that is, you know, I've had serious health problems since I was 18 years old, and the thing that keeps me active is being engaged in these projects that I'm concerned about. It's not, you know, when I think about what gets me up, like what painkiller works for my situation, it's engagement, it's social engagement. And right now I've just sort of come off of a series of surgeries, and I cannot wait to be back to the work that I love because it makes me feel better in every regard. But one of the things that was interesting to me, and no doctor has ever told me whether this is possible or not, but what I noticed, so I used translators, and they got sicker more than me. I mean, most of the translators hadn't been in these conditions before either. They were middle class or you know, they had college educations. And I did much better. And I thought, it's possible that because I have lived most of my life with some kind of pain and discomfort, I'm not, that's sort of my baseline. It's not a baseline of feeling great. It's feeling, you know, okay, better. That maybe I wasn't as, yeah, like I said, as discombobulated by that. And it's possible because, you know, because I have this raging immune system, autoimmune, that there's a possibility that autoimmunity was beneficial in some regards in terms of the waterborne disease. I'm not sure. I mean, I did get sick. I did fall in this, you know, the sewage lake, and, you know, just that took me out for a couple days. I got fevers, but not, but it was actually in terms of the, you know, the health issues, it was, the big stuff I avoided. So, yeah, it's a very interesting question. You know, I should ask a doctor someday if that's, you know, if it's possible that autoimmunity could be an advantage in, you know, public health hazard land.
Do you think that your health issues, you know, affect the way that the people you're working with feel about you? In other words, you're somebody who, you're elite, you're educated, you're from, you know, the United States, but you kind of do have a vulnerability. Does that affect them, you think?
You know, it's not something that, you know, what I feel is that, first of all, I think it has absolutely everything. I mean, it's central to my understanding of the volatility of life, which is why I've chosen to use time as a construct, why I'm interested in not just taking snapshots of people where they are, but following their ups and downs over time. It's that unpredictability of, you know, of one's health that, you know, is just one of many, and economic unpredictability is particularly in a global age, that's, you know, that is the, you know, that volatility is the essential condition. And so if you take a snapshot, you miss that. Yes, I think that there was Fatima, if you've read the book, Fatima was this disabled mother of three who eventually sets herself on fire. And in the beginning, when I would go in there, Fatima, somebody had made Fatima, it was like a broken plastic chair with two bicycle wheels, and it was her wheelchair. She mainly used it, but it was, and so people would just like kick it at me and say, one leg, you know, here's your wheelchair. They would make fun, they would learn that I have all these titanium metal parts, and when they get mad at me, they'd be like, we're going to cut off your arms and take the metal out of you and sell it for scrap, you know, we're going to make a fortune. So, like, that whole context of making fun of me because of my, just that was sort of part of the joke.
Yeah.
And it was, and it certainly wasn't, oh, mighty Kate is here to take our stories and, you know, make us, you know, and I think, and the other thing that was, that I think where my disability, my difference, my frailty is, I mean, by the end of the project, I was like 90 pounds. I really was frail. But I think that the police and the corrupt officials definitely thought this person cannot possibly be doing anything serious. So they were doing all manner of things in front of me. And, you know, they just thought, I think they just thought I was some insane person who was, you know, had a fetish for poverty and was there and that, you know, or some people thought, you know, might have thought that I was there to steal children or, you know, but I don't think anybody thought I was a journalist except for the slum dwellers. Anybody believed it except for the slum dwellers, and they did believe it.
All right, other questions? Yes.
Hi.
On the along the same lines, since family was so much part of the aspirations and the dilemmas that your characters pursued, did they ask you about your marriage?
Yes.
Can you tell more about that?
That's funny. Well, yeah, and they didn't meet my husband until 6 months in the project. He was working in that. First, they couldn't believe, they wanted to know what was wrong with my husband, what my husband's physical defect was, because, you know, obviously I couldn't, you know, didn't have a proper husband, you know, so could my husband walk, was my husband blind? So they, you know, and I was saying, no, you know, my husband likes me even though I'm, you know, and he's healthy and, you know, but they didn't really believe that. So they were waiting to meet him to see what was wrong with him. And then they did meet him. Well, and then they were. Then the other thing that they thought is they thought that he must have left me or didn't love me, because if he loved me, would I be in the slum at 2 a.m. working on my own? And I was working a lot on my own at first, because the translators were like, would come and look at the job and say, this is terrible conditions and I'm not going to, you know, thank you anyway. So they really did not, they just thought there was something they were going to, you know, that I did, either I didn't have a husband or the husband was, you know, was a defective. And they, you know, and they knew he was Indian. And when they met him, he's, you know, he's a professor, he's a public intellectual. They really also had a hard time understanding that he was Indian, because he wasn't like any Indian that they'd ever met. They'd never met an Indian with that level of education. And it was for him, as a patriot and somebody who's worked, you know, hard on you know, on these issues within India. It was also for him an incredible experience to get to know the people of Anawadi, because he had not, I think that he also, he like so many people in this country or in India, underestimated the intellectual potential of the people in that community. And I think for him it lit a fire under him. It was like, you know, what something that he believed in intellectually became more of an emotional crusade after that. So.
Yes.
On the topic of intellectual potential of people in the slums, what is your sense? I mean, I know people in the slums do not have technology, but on a recent trip to India, I was super impressed by how many people actually had cell phones mm-hmm. and were, in fact, connecting right. to a lot of things. So what is your impression of the people you were working with, how technology has or has not entered their lives, and what kind of difference might it be making?
I mean, it is connecting them to the world, and even to the fact that I'm in Kansas, because there's this one kid who can get the internet and he follows, like, you know, and so they will know today that in the Lawrence paper there was a note about my talk last night. So they are able to have access to this and through their phones, and it's a great priority of the Indian government and of profit making manufacturers of electronics to connect more people, because it's one of the world's biggest untapped markets still. And I think it is going to change a lot for better or worse. I mean, kids in slums aren't on Facebook. They're not on OkCupid or whatever. You know, they're, you know, in some ways it's a, you know, adolescence is a much more innocent thing, because they're offline, they're in their communities, and that's going to change, but it's also going to allow them to have access to information they never would have had. It's going to connect them. And this term in the slum, it's exposure. People say, you know, they long for exposure. one of the reasons that I began my book the way I did with the night when Abdul Hussein is falsely accused of burning his neighbor and he has to hide from the police. And in the Bollywood movies, he'd be like running across the city on the top of speeding trains. But the reality is he had nowhere to go because he knew nowhere outside of his slum. He'd spent 16 hours a day with his head bent into his garbage. And the smallness of those worlds cannot be overestimated when I try to ask people to go to school. Like if there's a good school a mile away, it's, you know, it's like going to the moon. It's not possible. It's like gang territory in housing projects in the United States. Is you don't feel safe when you go outside your boundary. And I think that access to technology is a way of making those boundaries more elastic. And for the things that will be lost in terms of innocence, there will be things gained in terms of the sense of their own connection to the world and their own sense of hope and possibility. These are all great questions.
Victor.
Yeah, thanks. You're obviously very much at ground level in all you're doing here. I'd just like to go higher, like 30,000 feet just for a moment. Very often I think poverty experts, so-called, tend to say that the best antidote to poverty is economic growth. Mm-hmm. That in a way economic growth floats all boats,
right.
Employment becomes more evident, wages perhaps begin to go upwards and so on. But clearly this is not alone anymore about national economic growth.
Right.
Now clearly it's global. And I thought one of your examples last night was very telling, that the Beijing Olympics impacts the price of recycled trash back in India. I mean, clearly a metonym, you might say, for global market capitalism. But I'm not sure, sitting here, whether this is a cause for hope or a cause for despair. It suggests, obviously, less reliance upon national fortunes and now more reliance upon global fortunes. But are those global fortunes any more reliable, any more consistent? One presumes not. So I'm not sure whether this is hope or cause for hope or despair.
You know, I think that's the essential question. And, you know, in a context where, in Anawadi, six people out of 3,000 have permanent work, and I would come back to D.C., where, which is my hometown, and my friends would be like, it must be so different here. And I'm like, well, you're unemployed. You're working temp. You're working. You've changed your job 20 times. You know this, because it's, you know, what you have is what they call in India the precocious form of growth, which is growth, growth without, you know, a parallel increase in permanent, consistent labor. So the volatility is out of the world. As the Beijing Olympics scrap is up, I could not believe when the banks failed in Manhattan, a week later the bottom had fallen out of the scrap industry in Mumbai. You know, and this is the kind of thing where I always say reporting is important, because that had never been, you know, nobody was documenting that. Nobody, if you don't go out there, you don't see those linkages happening. So I think what's the real question is now what governments can do or charity to react to that incredible volatility in the market. You know, is it better or worse? It's just constantly changing, and that, like, if you just think about, you think about, I think about my mother's era, and what poverty and, you know, and work in, say, a factory was like. You maybe you didn't have much, but you went in every day to the place and you knew the other people that you worked next to. And so your kid gets sick and you don't have money to pay the doctor. Well, maybe there's somebody you've had lunch with for 5 years who's going to lend you that $20. Now you go in and it's like a different person all the time. You don't have those same relationships. Your relationship to your community is you know, the workforce. Is different. Your relationship to your community is different because everybody's competing for too little work. And that, you know, that the toll that takes on families and communities, I feel, is still an undocumented question. I feel that, you know, in India and in the United States, there are profound changes because of this global connection and instability that have not been fully grasped, either I mean, not just by citizens, but also by the politicians and the people, you know, and philanthropists, the people whose business it is really to make life a little more secure for the citizens. I think it's the essential question.
May I piggyback off of that?
And sure. Just,
I'm really interested in the way that capitalism, global capitalism, sort of hovers over the life of the lives of the people you've documented. And in particular, you know, you talked last night about how drugs and violence are such a central part of inner city life, for instance, in the United States, but that was less the case in Mumbai. It seemed to me in your story, when I was reading it, that capitalism sort of was the drug, this belief in possibility and the belief that if you worked hard enough, you could
right.
make it. And, you know, as a reader, I immediately just felt like, you know, I don't think that's the case. I'm sort of a pessimist, as I think Victor is as well, about whether that's true. But of course, last night you reminded us these statistics that show that extreme poverty has fallen.
Right.
And so I'm kind of wondering, and this is a tough question maybe, but, you know, how, perhaps I'm just restating Victor's, how do you actually evaluate the impact of global capitalism on the lives of the people you've now been documenting for, you know, 20 years? Is this a general improvement at the cost of individual suffering, or is this a force that leads really to dystopia?
Well, you know, I think that the important thing to bring out, you know, and let's just talk about India for a second, is that in the course of my reporting, I didn't meet anyone over 50 who longed for the time before economic liberalization of 1991. So going in, I expected that the people themselves would have a much stronger critique of this new volatility that had been introduced into their lives, and they didn't, because, you know, I mean, Abdul Hussein's mother, you know, said essentially, you know, were we better when we were all like in it together in a situation of companionable misery? No. People had that hope. And the question, and I think that's true in the United States too, in many immigrant communities that I've worked in, is that they are on, this is the drug, and they want it because it beats the other drug.
Right.
And that other drug wasn't working for them. So one of the things that was so shocking to me at the end of my project, when I was looking to say, where's the hope, making sure that in this one community, I was really considering, were there success stories that I wasn't seeing? And there weren't. We agonized over it. There was just the only success story that we saw was on the basis of a very capitalistic approach to anti-poverty program, you know, the corruption was the way out. But is it for me to say that this, you know, this real hope that people feel for the possibility? I mean, it's true in the United States. This statistics used to show, and I'm not sure if this is true, that many people felt that even though they were poor now, that in the next 10 years they would be in the 1%. People, you know, there's this delusion, and it keeps them alive. It keeps them going. And I think in India, it's really an open question about whether the hopes of 1.2 billion people are going to be realized, or whether there's going to be just a spectacular conflagration when those hopes are dashed.
So when you talked to the people who you met, did they have success stories that they remembered? Was there the story of, you know, such and such?
There was the story of such and such. So there was the story of, like, the one guy who got a government job and who left the slum.
Right.
But the other thing that I, you know, one of the things, this life in, you know, in, given the situation of the market volatility and the lack of permanent work, people are just reinventing themselves constantly. And it's just the effort that takes is abrading. It abrades your capacity. It wears away on your soul. And I think that toward the end of the book, I quote Karim Hussein, Abdul's father, and he says, you know, it's like you see the bus and you know it's coming, and you know you're just, you know, if you run faster now than you've ever run before, you might just get it. But there it goes. And after all you've been through, how fast can you really run? That And then there's the girl, Kale, who says, we try so many things, and the world doesn't work in our favor. The capacity for reinventing yourself, and, you know, it's not unlimited. Resilience is not an inexhaustible supply. And what you see, and one of the reasons why you see in a place like Anahuasca so many of the men have retreated into alcoholism is because they've tried as hard as they can and they don't have it anymore. And it's the women who, for their children, are at this point sustaining that hope in the market.
All right, other questions? Yes.
These are really great questions. I'm thoroughly enjoying this.
Thank you. Last night, you touched upon, you answered someone's question about what can we do here, mm-hmm. if we have money that we to donate, who to donate to. I looked up the website when I got home that you mentioned, and it didn't seem to be helpful. It talked about giving up to $100,000. I mean, not that I personally could give it, but certainly a few people could give it.
It's funny. I guess I should say how I use it. Oh. You can type in the name of, I should have been clearer, you type in the name of a charity that you are interested in, and then you can read the dialogue between these people who think a lot about what's sound giving and the organizations, if the organizations have responded, and more every day organizations are responding to what they spend on programming, why they feel what they're doing is important, what the evidence is, what studies have been done. And it just takes you deeper into your charity of choice than you will ever be able to go through fundraising materials. And it also gives you a recommendation for the three charities that they pick every year that they feel, after rigorous studies, have the capacity to grow with money and have the most justification for doing what they're doing. And I mentioned last night this charity that I support for a long time called Deworm the World that worked out of Africa and now is in India. And just recently it was put on their top three. But they really look at because they look at what the capacity is to expand the process. And these people are just starting out in India. There's they have a track record of accountability and transparency and self-criticism, which is, I think, very important in these organizations, that they're able to say, well, that didn't work so well, but we're going to try this, an honest accountability. So those three organizations alone that they name are places where the need is acute, and there's a sense that those organizations can deliver on the promises that they made for donors.
Maybe you want to mention that website again for anyone who wasn't there last
night. Yeah, and thank you for clarifying that. I never noticed it. It's called givewell.org. And there was one more question somewhere. Hi.
I wanted to ask you to follow up also about what you mentioned last night about empathy. And think that you are always thinking about how can you build empathy in the work that you produce. And I'm wondering on this theme of what you found works for you and what doesn't work, or weaknesses and strengths, how have you worked on that in terms of literally on narrative structure or even like audience? Like, are some audiences or some readers more open, more receptive?
Mm. It's a great question. And I will say that when I have a friend, another serious writer of nonfiction, who reads my work and I read his work, and back and forth over the years, because he does this, it's a very weird profession and there's not that many of us, and so we support each other. And when he read an early draft of my book, he said, don't put in the part about how there's electricity and a fan in the slum. Don't put in the part that, like, somebody has a television, because people won't empathize with slum dwellers if they know that they have access to television. And then he said to me, don't write much about Asha, and only write about her in the context of Manju, her virtuous daughter. And he said, you can't have Cruella de Vil until you have your 101 Dalmatians. And this is, I hear over and over and over again from editors and everything that oh, the audience won't care if you're writing about people who may have flaws. They may be, you know, they want, people only want these cardboard characters, of, you know, these perfectly virtuous people who are sitting there in the dirt saying, woe is me. And my argument has always been that the way you build empathy is you show people thinking and acting in a way that a mother in Lawrence can identify with Zerenisa, you know, who's, you know, in her hut with her baby on the breast and the, you know, and her son, daughter, and husband in jail. Like, those connections are possible. If you strip away the wiring, the, you know, the connective tissue is pretty much the same everywhere. But the problem is that people don't bother to, they don't, you know, people don't bother to show it. So I feel really strongly that the American reading public is much more sophisticated than many of us writers allow. You know, and that people also, you know, that you readers know, you know, when you're reading a sentimental story that's, you know, where the person in the, you know, in the story is so perfect and virtuous, you know that maybe the reporter is just leaving out anything that might turn you off. So, you know, I write for that reader who is sophisticated enough to judge a person in the round. In terms of the structure of the book, it's a great question, and that the tone, because there was no urgency to this book, like, why, you know, you never heard of this slum, these are totally ordinary people, your world, you're not going to feel an absence if you don't know about what goes on in Anahuasi, you know, so why would you care? That I had to get the tone to capture the immediacy and, again, the volatility of life in that community, and so just so the reader would go headlong into that experience along with the slum dwellers. And I was able, in part, in the writing to do that because I had the videotapes, because I had the audio tapes, because when I wasn't sitting back 3 years later and saying, I remember what it was like when, you know, the night that Fatima set herself on fire, it was like there in the, you know, in the documentation. And then I was able to use that documentation to bring the reader into my own sense of urgency. And I think that if I, you know, if I hadn't had that, if, which goes back to what I said in the beginning, if I hadn't faced down my weaknesses and realized what I was not good at and made adjustment for them, I wouldn't have been able to convey what if, you know, not just what happens, but what it feels like for people like Manju, who is trying, you know, realizes that her best friend has eaten rat poison and she's trying to save her. You know, what does that feel like? That all comes from the style, the sentence structure, the way that it moves comes from having that evidence and being able to listen to it over and over and over again and doing my best to bring it to you.
Allie?
I'll ask a question since I have the mic. One theme that kind of I noticed throughout the book was this sort of difference between rural and urban and kind of the relationship between, you know, how flight from rural areas was sort of feeding a lot of the population right. of the slums. And I think in a place like Kansas, that's something that maybe we could also, you know, sort of relate to, that most of the state is rural. And I'm just wondering what you saw of the effect that that's having on rural areas. I mean, I think, you know, the description of what's happening in the slum from, you know, this kind of rural exodus, but what's going on in rural areas because of that? And do you think that the options for potential social mobility are in reality better in Mumbai than they are in a rural area?
Absolutely, absolutely. And one of the reasons why my book, in I think it's chapter 10, steps back and takes you to Avadharva village is to show, it's something that I emphasized last night. You know, you have to remember that on the books, these people are not poor in Mumbai. They're part of the success story. In places like Avadharva, for landless people, the situation is absolutely desperate, and there are... And the people who can have already left. And so what you have is these hollowed out communities of farm workers who are working in conditions so that by the time they're 40, their bodies are wrecked. And they're inhaling the pesticides, their lungs are wrecked, their lives are extremely difficult. And I mean, right now, I think in the next couple of years, there will be more people in India's tier one cities than there are in the rest of this enormous, enormous country. But when you go to those villages, the aspirations are just the same. People want to go to college. They know now because there is more awareness of what's going on. There are, you know, there is access. You know, sometimes one person in a village will have a TV and then everybody will go and watch it. There's an awareness now of what is possible in the world that there wasn't in, you know, in China of the 50s or 60s. You know, there is across the world now an awareness in very, very poor communities of how the other half lives. And that has created a violent dynamic in areas of India where people in a Maoist movement, the Naxalites, have actually taken arms against the government and the police and corporations. And in some cases for the very good reason that corporations are usurping their land. When you look at a place like Anawadi in Mumbai, where there's an essential lawlessness if you're very poor, that you have no access to justice. That, unfortunately, that's a condition shared across. That's one of the few things anymore that rural and urban India have in common. If you're poor, you simply don't have access to the rights of law.
So on the theme of government, I want to ask sort of a big question that maybe draws on your many years of reporting in the U.S. and now in India. When we think about the sort of landscape of social welfare provision, NGOs are often heralded by people on both sides of the ideological mm-hmm. divide as these, you know, beacons of hope. They're more flexible and responsive and more targeted in their interventions than governments mm-hmm. are. And you've had a chance to see state governments, you know, municipal governments right. in the United States, the national government in the United States. You've got lots of experience through those Freedom of Information Act requests. And now you've also seen the Indian government and its the municipal government of Mumbai. I was really interested in your sort of revelations about NGOs in the book. What, in terms of your sense of who does it better, do you have kind of a scheme for evaluating social welfare provision in terms of, you know, NGOs versus the state?
Well, I think it's an immense trade-off because, you know, if you look right now at the current state of education across India, not just in Mumbai, but municipal schools, that the public schools are absolute disgraces. Essentially, the teachers there are part of a patronage system, and in many cases, they feel absolutely, they pay under the table to get their jobs, and they feel absolutely no obligation to teach the students. And therefore, what, you know, if you want to get an education, almost nobody who attends, this is, I mean, just crazy, almost nobody who attends public education in India today gets to college. Almost nobody. So the education is for profit or charitable institutions that, you know, successful, you know, that for people who hope to make it into the lower echelons of the elite. That said, is that good policy going forward? No, absolutely not. I think the United States and its provision of public education to grade 12 for free, that's a far fairer way to distribute educational opportunity. And public education schools in the United States are more accountable to the public than private schools are. And that's why in my own giving, in my own, you know, thinking about what to do about, you know, how to do my small part to address social problems, it's crucial to support the people in India who are working against corruption and for accountability and for improvements in those public services, including access to water. Because in the long run, you know, charity is going to do enormous amounts, but in the long run, if you're really talking about closing the inequality gap and allowing more of the potential on this planet to be given wing, you're really talking about making governments accountable. I mean, that's where, that's the harder work, and that I think is the essential work of the 21st century.
And that's, of course, the tension between economic globalization, which is eroding
the power of the nation state,
right? And at the same time, the enormous need for state activity in terms of social provision.
Exactly.
Fascinating. All right, other questions?
Do you think Modi is going to make a difference with this, the BJP?
I don't know. I mean, he's got a pretty terrible history in terms of Gujarat and the treatment of Muslims that is already painfully divisive. At the same time, he's got an emphasis on anti-corruption and accountability that is probably useful. And in general, what I feel about that election was that it was the Congress Party had been in power, but where the Congress Party had these strong secular values, whatever, but it had grown so corrupt and so uncountable that whatever you think of Modi, the fact that they were shaken from this, you know, essentially dynastic power is going to be good long run for the health of the government. And I have many, many fears about a Modi government, but my fears about a government that's never challenged and that hasn't been accountable are perhaps equal.